This episode of the Art of Manliness podcast is brought to you by Athletic Greens. Besides eating right, exercising regularly, and getting enough sleep, one thing I do to make sure I'm running on all eight cylinders is take a shot of Athletic Greens first thing in the morning. Athletic Greens is different from other greens products out there. It's the most complete whole food supplement available with 75 ingredients working together to help with 11 different areas of health. Plus, it tastes a lot better than a lot of the other greens products out there. Got a special deal for Art of Manliness listeners. If you want to start trying out Athletic Greens, got a special offer that includes a one-off supply of 20 free Athletic Green travel packs valued at $99.95. Each travel pack is perfectly measured to give you optimum balance of daily superfood nutrition, whether you're at home, at the office, or on the road. So you want to get these 20 free Athletic Green travel packs, just go to athleticgreens.com/AOM. Again, athleticgreens.com/AOM for 20 free Athletic Greens travel packs. Brett McKay here, and welcome to another edition of the Art of Manliness podcast, where we don't normally think of soldiers and first responders as professional athletes, but that's exactly how my guest today argues they should see themselves. His name is Rob Shaul, and he's the founder and president of the Mountain Tactical Institute. It's a research organization dedicated to creating fitness programming that takes workouts outside the gym and gives them a mission-centered focus. Rob believes that soldiers, police officers, firefighters, even plumbers and HVAC guys, and folks who participate in strenuous mountain activities like rock climbing and backcountry skiing should view themselves as professional athletes and train not just to train, but for a purpose outside the gym. And today on the show, Rob and I discuss what makes the Mountain Tactical Institute's mission-focused approach to fitness different from other organizations, why it is that soldiers and first responders should think of themselves as professional athletes, why soldiers serving in Afghanistan started following his fitness programming for mountain climbers, why there's so many out-of-shape first responders on active duty, and how to train to become a tactical athlete, even if you're a civilian. Great show, packed with information. After the show's over, check out the show notes at aom.is/tacticalathlete, where you can find links to resources where you can delve deeper into this topic. Rob Shaul, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you, Brad. Good morning.
So you own a company, founded a company called Mountain Tactical Institute back in 2007. Originally was a mountain athlete, but it's now called Mountain Tactical Institute. I'm curious, before we get into talking about MTI, what was your background before that? What prompted you to start Mountain Athlete?
Lifelong gym rat on the fitness side. Went to Coast Guard Academy, was in the Coast Guard for 5 years after school and military. Then went and got my master's degree, actually in political science as my education. And then I moved back to Wyoming and started a company did that for 10 years and decided to sell that and wanted to do something else. And I just one of those guys who kind of would go to the gym and train, and pretty much other people would see me train and want to start training with me. And I was just in a small town in Wyoming, a little bit south of Jackson here where I grew up, just training in a physical therapy, like little gym. It was the only thing we had in this town. Pretty much a universal machine, a few free weights, some dumbbells. And the lady who owned that said, "Hey, I want you to start coaching for me." And I kind of started doing that. And one thing led the other, and it just kind of worked out where I wanted to go ahead and transition into coaching. And that's kind of what got me there. Jackson, the town I was in, was a little bit too small for what I wanted to do. And so Jackson is a really interesting place. And I started a company called Mountain Athlete. I wanted to come up here and work with some of the athletes up here, specifically mountain guides. And so I came up here and reached out to one of the guiding companies, said, "Hey, I'll train your guys for free." And made a lot of early mistakes. And everything's kind of developed from that.
So what's MTI's focus? I mean, it's called Mountain Tactical Institute. So I'm guessing it's mountain athletes and tactical guys.
Yeah, kind of our company mission is to improve mountain and tactical mission performance and keep these types of athletes safe. So that's really our focus. We, for years, had primarily emphasized fitness programming and fitness training. We did some other stuff, too, on the tactical side. We actually developed a system to train accurate marksmanship under stress, believe it or not. Did a lot of shooting. But then just about a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, we expanded our reach to start taking a look at policy, safety issues, gear. And so now we're pretty much a research institute. We cover all those different areas, anything that has to do with mountain or tactical performance and mission success, we're interested in taking a look at.
So with the mountain athletes, why do you think these folks needed specialized fitness programming? Isn't doing their job or activity enough? I mean, if you want to get better at skiing, like just go backcountry ski a lot.
You're right. There was really no, and there really is no strong tradition of gym-based fitness programming for mountain athletes, especially on the recreational side. Now the high-level athletes do this type of stuff. The high-level rock climbers and obviously the alpine race skiers, U.S. ski team, those types of folks do a lot of gym-based programming. But for even the backcountry skiers or the alpinists, there was really no strong tradition of that. And my approach was just to get in there and see what we could do and develop a programming that transferred to mission performance. I think that as more and more athletes started doing these sports, we saw a couple things. First, because of the X Games and Free Ski World Tour, there was a little bit more money and emphasis and media attention on some of these sports. And what that did was it started attracting a higher level of athlete. Here in Jackson, it's pretty amazing how many collegiate Division I athletes come into the gym to train, and they're here, you know, ski bumming or trying to develop their alpine mountain athlete type resume. And so I think that the sport started attracting better athletes, and those athletes had a background in strength conditioning, especially a lot of the collegiate athletes. And then also because of the attention on the media side, the competition for attention and what people were doing on the outside just kept on increasing and increasing. So all those different factors have worked together. I'll be the first to admit that it's still not strong in these communities. That's one of the things that we've always kind of struggled with. And I've kind of got away from trying to convince people how, on the mountainside, how proper programming will improve their performance. We've just been doing it too long. Now we just do it and let our athletes speak for us. We've had some really great success with some athletes.
So your initial programming was geared towards mountain athletes, rock climbers, skiers, things like that. How did your programming come to the attention of military members, and how did that transition into tactical or military athlete?
Yeah, 2008, 2009, you know, I remember we would just put our sessions up online, and I remember just getting emails from guys downrange in Iraq and Afghanistan mad at me because I hadn't got the session up for that day online yet. Of course, they were ahead of us or behind us on and it just started building and building. And especially on the Afghanistan side, we had military units who were deploying to really mountainous regions at altitude, and their patrol mission set included a lot of up and down hiking under load, and they just were getting there unfit for it. And so our work on the mountainside, we had guys reach out to us to start developing programming to get guys ready, and we developed a program we called the Afghanistan Pre-Deployment Training Program, which we gave away. And we gave that away to thousands of guys. We had battalion commanders deploy it with their entire battalions, lots of individual guys, lots of platoon leaders and squad leaders and up and down the chain. And it was just a program we developed from what we'd learned working here on the mountainside on how to get athletes ready in a gym-based setting where they don't have a mountain outside. If you're in Fort Campbell, Kentucky, or Fort Bragg, North Carolina, you can't go hike up and down a mountain. But to kind of use what they had, really basic equipment, and do the best we could to get them ready to go downrange. So that's kind of what got us our start.
So, I mean, like, what do you think is lacking in the default physical training in the armed services currently, where you had guys in Afghanistan and Iraq saying, I'm going to go to this outside source to get my physical training in?
really just knowledge. Just how do you train to climb up and down, you know, mountains when you first, once you, because guys would deploy and get downrange, and you know, the next day they'd be out on patrol. So how do you train for that? And the traditional, we were coming along, you know, CrossFit had a huge impact on military guys also, greater than us. And so guys would do CrossFit, or they would do typical military PT, which is running, push-ups, and sit-ups, and find they got down range and they just weren't performing well when they did their patrols. So that kind of led to them seeking us out. Just in that aspect of that, it was just a knowledge of how you program and train for that. And that kind of got us going on this idea of working with the different sports that we work with, and then with these different mission sets on the tactical side. It helped us get more and more focused on designing sport-specific or event-specific or mission-specific programming, fitness programming, for whatever that mission is going to be. So we went from designing a general training program for mountain athletes to designing a season-specific program for lift-assisted alpine skiing, designing a really mission-specific programming for one of our athletes who attempted to ski, to climb and ski a major peak in the Wrangell Mountains up in Alaska. So we, what we found is that we, as we started doing more and more programming, our stuff got more and more specific. From a general training program for mountain athletes, all-around mountain athletes, to a season-specific programming for something like lift-assisted skiing, to a really specific program for an athlete who is going to do a backcountry major ski mountaineering expedition, a single 24-hour push for a peak in the Wrangell Mountains in Alaska. And all those different types of programming from the fitness perspective are different. And what we've developed is a methodology on how to identify the fitness demands of the sport, of a season, of a specific event, work backward from those demands, identify the fitness programming which trains those demands and gets an athlete ready sport specifically for that event or mission or sport or whatever it is. So our currency in terms of the athletes that we work with is that methodology, how we put all that stuff together to develop programming that really transfers outside the gym to mission-specific performance.
Okay, and we'll talk a little bit more about what your programming looks like in a bit here. But let's talk about military athlete a bit. So, you know, as you, the number of requests you were getting for mission-specific and more tactical-specific programming increased, you started military athlete. Let's say, I'm sure there's plenty of listeners who are listening to the show right now and they're thinking of joining the military or they want to get selected for special forces. Based on your experience with working with thousands of different of individuals in the military world, what are the most important things that listener should know in order to prepare for the physical training portion of that?
Not to assume that just being fit in one area will make you fit for what you're going to face at boot camp or at special forces selection or whatever. What we say is that the further you are away from the event, the more general your programming can be. And as you get closer, the more specific it should be. So, for example, guys who do a lot of CrossFit can't assume that because they're smoking these 3 to 5 minute super intense gym-based exercises or events in a CrossFit that that's going to transfer over to being able to rock 12 miles with 45 pounds. You know, in 3 hours at the end of a long 10-hour day of getting smoked by the cadre. So there's just the idea is to focus on or identify kind of what you're going to be facing and then train for that. And just understand that not all programming transfers well, and identify the programming that transfers well or the preparation that will transfer well to the event.
That's great. And I've also noticed on your site too that you've also expanded into creating programming for law enforcement officers and fire and rescue professionals and first responders. And I guess there was a need for that. I mean, you had a blog post where you talked about the number of first responders who are out of shape, like not just like they can't run very far, like they're obese or whatever. Do you have any statistics about the number of out of shape first responders in the U.S. out there?
Not to that level. We do know that, for example, in 2015, the number one cause of firefighter deaths was cardiac arrest, which is just heart attacks. And that's consistently the issue. What we kind of happened was we had many military guys were moving out of they get out of the service and they would go to the first responder world, especially in the law enforcement side. And then we also got some currency within the law enforcement guys on the side who were in there already, who found our stuff and started wanting us to start programming for cops and detectives and SWAT teams. And the programming is different than the military stuff. But amongst the first responder community in general, there is not a strong fitness culture. One of the things the military has that many, or the vast majority of first responder units doesn't have, is an annual high jeopardy fitness assessment. High jeopardy means you don't do well, you can lose your job. Many, all the academies for the fire academies or the law enforcement academies, they have entry-level gate fitness assessments, and fitness is a big part of the academy. But once guys and women, I guess, get out of the academy, they go into their units or their departments, there's no more, for most units, there's no more fitness assessments. Or if there is a fitness assessment, it doesn't have high jeopardy, or the standards are so low that it's a joke. And so what we've kind of found is that we've actually studied, we set some researchers just to study the fitness culture at a fire department in a mid-sized city in the Midwest. And we developed, I sent a PhD and another researcher, and that was one of the things we wanted to take a look at, you know, can we develop a fitness culture assessment? So we took a look at, you know, individual interviews, we interviewed the command, we kind of observed to see how much guys were training. At this department, every station had kind of a tiny little fitness room where they had some, you know, dumbbells and plenty of stuff to train. Equipment's never a reason, but this department, there was actually a requirement that the firefighters train every day they were on duty, and they had to sign something, or their their station captain had to sign something to verify they did it. And there were some integrity issues. Guys were signing and they weren't training. It was just part of this kind of culture. Certainly there were guys at this department who were very fit, but many of them were fit not for work, but for their sport. So there were some triathletes who just did endurance stuff, and some powerlifters who just did power, you know, heavy lifting. You can kind of see how that works. But so what we found was there's a lacking kind of a programming to train for their work, their job, their profession, and then also just a pretty poor culture. We actually took a look at the articles that we wrote last year in 2016 and identified which ones were the most read, and the one that was the most read was I wrote an article was titled, you know, First Responders, How Come You Tolerate Unfit Police and Firefighters? We had heard when I've worked with lots of these guys and taught courses at departments, and there's all lots of excuses on why first responders as a general, there's just not a strong fitness culture. And I just started thinking about it, that it's an incredible safety issue. An unfit fireman or a police officer can get himself killed or herself killed, and some of the people in the department, no matter what it is, killed also. It's a huge safety issue. But it's not really thought of that way. There are some other things that kind of prevent a strong fitness culture from being developed. One is that unions often fight fitness standards or fitness assessments. down in Colorado Springs a couple years ago, really enlightened. Colorado Springs is where the headquarters of the National Strength Conditioning Association is, and the local police department kind of worked with the NSCA, kind of enlightened chief at the police department, to implement a high jeopardy fitness assessment at that department. And they had a gentle on-ramp for this fitness assessment to let everybody in the department know it was coming. Everybody took it. You know, they had a chance to get up and do it well. Plenty of time. You know, coaching was offered. And it finally got jeopardy when it was finally implemented. Several of the female members didn't pass the assessment. And one of the first – it was a jeopardy assessment. So one of the first things that happened is if you didn't pass, you were taken off the street and put on desk duty until you passed it. And there was a lawsuit that came out of that. The officers who didn't pass sued the department. A judge put a stay on the fitness assessment. This is a fairly common thing. So there are just some things on the military side in terms of culture, in terms of this high jeopardy fitness assessment that is done every year, how it's related to – you can't be an up-and-coming officer in the Army these days and not have a pretty smoking PFT score. It's going to hurt your performance evaluation. All those things make it easier to have a stronger fitness culture in the military, and those tools aren't there on the first responder side. The other thing that's really interesting on the first responder side, there's just so many interesting things about it, is that in the military, if you get, you know, past 40, you're pretty much done being on the tip of the spear. You know, even on the enlisted side, you're high enough ranked where chances are you're not running and gunning with the boys anymore. But on the first responder side, that's not the case. I just saw a statistic today where the biggest block, age block for firefighters in the nation is like 41 to 50. So it's entirely possible to be a policeman or a firefighter in your late 40s or 50s and actually be, you know, the guy on the nozzle going in to fight the fire. And we work with several guys who do that. So they can work longer at, you know, kind of the tip of the spear and be in danger, which would point to even a greater need for fitness. But you've got this thing that's called legacy members, is the term for it. These legacy guys are like, you know, I'm too old to do that, or, you know, I didn't do that when I was coming up, so I don't need to train now, or I'm so street smart or fire aware that I'll never get myself in a situation where I'll need to you know, have a great fitness. It's just an interesting dynamic that really works against developing a fitness culture. The other thing that is kind of interesting, as I've worked with first responders, especially on the law enforcement side, but really both, how much respect I've gained for them. In the military, even if you're at a Tier 1 Special Forces unit, those guys generally know when they're going to be in harm's way and when they aren't. But for a policeman or a firefighter, it's like they're deployed all the time. You know, any normal traffic stop could result in, you know, a dangerous situation. It's just I really have developed a high level of respect for these athletes, and we've just been trying to work with them. Again, kind of like on the mountainside, we kind of step back and try to convince people why fitness is important. And we're trying to identify the people who agree with us in the first responder side, give them the tools they need to train sport specifically for their job, and just let others take notice. We kind of found that, in general, the top performers in the military first responder side also happen to be pretty darn fit. And there's a reason for that. Fitness improves everything. If you have a cop who just depends on his fitness, his body, to keep himself safe and his partner safe, and he's obviously deconditioned, it makes you wonder about how that cop is dealing the other aspects of his profession. You know, is he doing his paperwork properly? You know, is he going to the range and he's spending time with his weapon? Is he reading the latest on case studies? I mean, what we've kind of found in general is that, and this is across all the communities that we work with. The guys who are the athletes, men and women who come in and train with us or follow our programming, are also the top levels of the other elements of their profession. So fitness trains everything. We here in Jackson, the guides, the mountain guides, professional mountain guides who spend the most time with us are the most experienced, highest level mountain guides. The young guides aren't in there training with us. It's the older guys who know the most who are in there training with us. They've come to realize the importance of fitness and how they want to be professional about that element of their job, just like everything else.
Well, I think it's interesting. You've been referring to police officers, military guys, firefighters as athletes. And I think that's a big thing you hit on your site and with what you do is you want first responders and military folks in the military to think of themselves as professional athletes or tactical athletes. Why do you think it's important that they have that mindset and think of themselves that way?
Well, if you're a cop and you get injured, you know, you can't do your job, you're not going to get paid. So there's a direct link between health and fitness for a first responder, a mountain guide, or a tactical athlete and their paycheck. Just like there is for an NFL quarterback. If an NFL quarterback gets injured because he's unfit or isn't fit coming into camp, he can lose his job. It's a direct link to his paycheck. That's kind of how I define an athlete. In that sense, we have a term we've used before called industrial athletes, plumbers, carpenters, HVAC guys. Those guys are athletes too. You know, if they get hurt or something and they're not fit enough to do the job, they're just not going to get paid. So it's almost an economic point that I want to make. But also, there's an idea. It's kind of cool to be a professional athlete. You know, I'm a strength and conditioning coach, so I kind of work out for a living, right? But there's no real transfer over to my real job. We are purposely use that term. We call the people who come to our gym athletes. We don't call them clients. The semantics is important. I think it lays it brings a level of currency to the work that they're doing. If they think themselves of athletes, I think it just helps them embrace this idea that they're training for the job and their fitness is an important part of their profession, a really important part of it. And hopefully it'll encourage them to invest in it, do it well, get self-educated, and also set an example for other first responders or military guys or mountain people out there to kind of follow their lead.
We're going to take a quick break for your word from our sponsors. All right, it's a new year, so you're probably setting goals. And one of those goals is probably to learn something new. So one thing I've done to learn something new this year is check out the courses on the Great Courses Plus. It's a fantastic service. They've got video lectures on a wide variety of topics, everything from philosophy, business, even how to take better pictures, all taught by world-class professors and experts. One course I'd recommend you check out at the Great Courses Plus is Famous Greeks, taught by my professor at the University of Oklahoma, Dr. J. Rufus Fears. You're going to go through all of Greek history from the Iliad and the Odyssey all the way up into Alexander the Great's campaigns. And the way he talks and conveys this history just brings it alive. He's going to talk about blood coming out of eyeballs. He'll mimic slashing people's throats with a staff. I mean, it just gets really vibrant there. So it's the Famous Greeks. If you want to try the Great Courses at a great discount, you get a full free month of the Great Courses Plus and have access to all their courses. You can do this by going to thegreatcoursesplus.com/manliness. Again, one free month by going to thegreatcoursesplus.com/manliness. Also by Blue Apron. So we know there's nothing like a good home-cooked meal. Brings the family together, just tastes better. The food's usually better for you compared to some of the stuff you'll get out in a restaurant that's full of fat and salt and things like that. We all know that cooking at home can be a hassle. You got to go to the grocery store, get the ingredients. Sometimes you get too much ingredients, and so a lot of it goes into the trash. Well, Blue Apron takes the hassle out of cooking at home. What they do is you go online to blueapron.com, you pick out the meals you'd like to cook at home, and they ship you a cold-packed box full of all the ingredients you need to make that meal with just the specific amount you need for that. Nothing more, nothing less. Comes with an instruction card on how to cook the meal. Most recipes are easy to do, take about 30 minutes to cook. And all the ingredients they use are sourced fresh. It's high quality stuff. tastes great. So they're, you know, chicken is raised as free range, pork is raised naturally, beef is raised humanely. All the produce they use are taken from farms that use regenerative farming practices. So it's top notch stuff. Some of the meals they got in January, for example, are seared pork chops with farro and cranberry chutney, spaghetti squash and marinara, mushrooms and garlic knots, spicy shrimp and Korean rice cakes with cabbage and furikake. I don't know how to say that word, but it sounds delicious. But I've had the seared pork chops. They're fantastic, on point. Anyways, I got a deal for Art of Manliness listeners. If you check out this week's menu, you can get your first three meals free with free shipping by going to blueapron.com/manliness. You'll love how good it feels and tastes to create incredible home cooked meals with Blue Apron. So don't wait. Again, blueapron.com/manliness. Blue Apron, a better way to cook. Also by Mack Weldon. If you're like most men, you've probably been wearing the same underwear brand since you were a teenager. It's time to upgrade your underwear. There's been a lot of changes, and one company that's been modifying and making men's underwear better is Mack Weldon. They use premium fabrics that use antimicrobial fabric that eliminates the stench from your underwear. Besides underwear, they make undershirts out of the same fabric and socks as well. And the shopping experience at Mack Weldon is super easy. You can get all your undergarments in one fell swoop just by going there. So check it out. And if you don't like your first pair of Mack Weldon underwear, just keep it and they'll still refund you and no questions asked. If you want to try this out at a discount, I got an offer for you. Go to MackWeldon.com and use promo code manliness at checkout for 20% off. MackWeldon.com, promo code manliness for 20% off. And now back to the show. What's the overarching philosophy behind becoming a tactical athlete? And I mean, are there different fitness or skill aptitudes a tactical athlete should have?
Yeah, we've actually even broken it down further. We've identified five types of tactical athletes and fitness demands for each type. Many of the fitness demands carry over, but some have all of them and some don't. So, for example, a military, you know, like an Army Ranger or infantryman or a Special Forces guy, they need a high relative strength. Relative strength is strength per body weight. We're not trying to develop Olympic weightlifters or world champion powerlifters or bodybuilders. We just want athletes who have high relative strength. Our strength standards for tactical athletes are not super aggressive and ambitious. In the strength world, they're, you know, relatively moderate. But for athletes who have a myriad of fitness demands, you know, they're fairly high level. We want them to have a high level of work capacity. But when we talk about work capacity, it's not like it's just any type of work capacity. Tactical athletes, law enforcement, fire rescue, military, they need to be able to do on the work capacity side, they need to be able to sprint repeatedly. Sprint, recover, sprint, recover, sprint, recover. So not only do they need high work capacity for multimodal stuff, we're not sure what type of event they're going to face out in the field. But we do know that in general, they need to be able to sprint. On the endurance side, our military athletes and our mountain athletes need a high level of endurance. But it's not just any type of endurance. Military athletes don't need to bike. They don't need to row. You know, they need to be able to run, and they need to be able to ruck run or ruck well for long distances and recover from it. On the mountain side, athletes need to be able to run and hike uphill under load and recover from it. On the law enforcement side, one of our fitness attributes for law enforcement guys on the patrol and detective side is upper body hypertrophy. A cop who has a big chest and biceps, that could be actually a tool to intimidate bad guys from trying something stupid. So we actually train our programming for cops. We'll have upper body hypertrophy in there, and we'll manipulate our sets and reps and have different cycles which emphasize upper body hypertrophy. We have identified fitness attributes for tactical athletes, and then amongst that community, which ones apply to the different professions, and then we program from there for those individual professions.
And I also noticed you also put emphasis on durability with across your different athletes.
Yeah, the more I've done worked with durability, the more, I guess, contrarian to what generally happens in the strength and conditioning world, I've become. Early on, we kind of jumped into the idea of durability and I went and got FMS certified through Greg Cook, and we implemented the FMS. Are you familiar with the FMS, Brett?
It's functional movement system, right?
Yeah, it's called the functional movement screen.
For our listeners who aren't familiar with that, can you explain what that is?
The functional movement screen is developed, I don't know, a decade or so ago by a couple of PTs on the East Coast. And what they claimed it did was it was just a screen of different movements and exercises that they could put athletes through that had some predictive value on injury in the event or whatever they were doing. So if athlete didn't score above a certain level in the screen, their chances of getting injured were greater, is what the FMS founders or designers claimed initially. And so this is a great, all of a sudden, it's a great tool. This is the idea. The idea in general is that really proper movement transfers to durability. And these guys claimed that they had a screen to identify what was a proper level of movement. And then based on how you did on the exercises they had on the screen, they had exercises you could train to get better at the screen. And we initially really jumped on that idea and did it with all our athletes and implemented their exercises. And we also followed what was going on with other PTs and other type of mobility and durability thought out there. But the more and more I worked with that type of stuff, the less and less value I thought it had. And it's continued. Right now, my durability equation is durability equals 95% sport/mission/event fitness plus 5% durability and mobility. There's an emphasis on the fitness side for sure. We've kind of come to the point where being sport specifically fit for whatever you're going to do is the greatest buffer you're going to have to stay durable. And when we started to take a look, and there's been several studies that have come out now who have questioned the FMS's ability to predict durability. There was one of the studies that initially caught my eye was of several hundred Marine Corps OCS candidates, and they were given the FMS, and the way I understood it was that the FMS predicted, you know, fairly well how much injury would come out of OCS. But then when they started taking a closer look at it, now it was the FMS plus their USMC PFT scores that really was the greatest predictable when they put them together. And then when you broke it out a little bit further, the PFT ski scores were really the greater, you know, had a greater alone than the FMS. Anyway, moved down and become and had more experience programming for athletes, we've identified the idea that we really want to make guys durable, but a huge part of that is get them sport specifically fit for their event. In this world of strength and conditioning, and I'm sure you've seen this in the interviews and stuff that you've done, I guess everything works and nothing works forever. And when I first started programming and designing, I was so righteous about so many things. You know, I'm never going to do this. I'm never going to do that. Or that's, you know, and the more I've done it, the less righteous I've become in general. But also the more skeptical I've become of single bullets that seem to just do more than, or just too good to be true, I guess. So from our perspective, the durability is primarily just a high degree of relative strength, high degree of sport-specific fitness. So if you're a guy going downrange and you're going to go to a tactical situation on the military side, chances are if you do come under fire, you're going to be sprinting, hitting the ground and shooting and getting up and doing it again. And if you're not used to doing that, you're not going to have the work capacity to do it. If you're not used to doing it under load, you know, with your kit and your weapons and all your ammo, you may not have the mid-session strength under, especially if you do it for a while, the strength endurance, and all that stuff can lead to injury. So durability is a huge part of what we do, obviously, and our focus is just getting guys sport-specifically fit for what they're going to be facing.
Right, so foam rolling, is it going to help you carry load sprinting?
We do a little bit of foam rolling, but it's not a huge part of what we do. All of our sessions include generally, mobility exercises. We'll plug in mobility exercises, especially in strength circuits. In the strength circuit, to keep guys busy, give them something to do as they're resting between sets. But also, we do know it carries. There is some carryover, but there's having a great overhead squat does not mean you won't get injured if you're not sport physically fit. At the same time, I've seen, it's just what I've kind of found anecdotally is the really good athletes, and I define a really good athlete as someone who really moves well in space. And so they're the ones who smoke the FMS. I found they're delicate for whatever reason. Part of that might be that really good athletes are much more in tune with their body, and so a little ding will make them, freak out. And other athletes, kind of like me, we don't score well on the FMS, but I'm like an F-150. My first truck was old 79 F-150, and that thing got dinged and beat up, and I run into walls with it, and it just kept on going. It was very durable. So I guess taking a step back, we just kind of found that the best thing I do for my athletes on the durability side is increase their relative strength and get them sports physically fit for the event or the mission or the job they have. That's the best thing I could do.
Rob, do you think there's any value for civilians striving to become a tactical athlete?
I think the best thing that anybody can do for their fitness life, what I've kind of found over the years in as a guy who's been I'm 48, kind of lifelong gym rat, is if you do your own programming, no matter what it is, you end up doing what you're good at or what you've always done. It's really easy to get into a rut. And so if you're a civilian and you have an office job, you really don't have a job that demands a certain level of fitness, what I recommend is, and there seems to be this path for civilians, they kind of get in the gym, they come in, or whatever fitness perspective they do, especially if they don't have a collegiate athlete background, it may be a high school athlete. They'll get out of, they'll go to college, they'll play intramurals or whatever, and then they'll get to their work life, and they'll end up doing aerobics or maybe getting endurance stuff, and then CrossFit or something similar will get them back in the gym, and they'll kind of be all excited about that for a while. And it seemed the evolution of the sport of fitness, which is pretty much what CrossFit is now athletes will take that fitness and they'll start doing stuff outside. And it seems their first stepping stone will be a Tough Mudder or Spartan Sprint race, or maybe a Go Ruck event, one of these kind of manufactured artificial outdoor events. They're definitely physically challenging, but are still artificial. What I kind of find is my prediction for the next step is athletes on the civilian side are kind of seeing this now, going ahead and saying, okay, I've kind of done a Tough Mudder event or whatever. Now I want to go on my own and do a rim to rim, push of the Grand Canyon, or I want to come and hike the Bridger Teton Wilderness Highline Trail, 50 miles in a week, backpack, or I want to go climb Rainier or Denali, or I want to get into rock climbing. So what is kind of interesting from a fitness perspective is all those different things you're doing outside the gym. If you're programming and training for those specifically in the gym, it keeps your gym life kind of really, there's just a lot of variety that you're going to be doing, and it'll keep you in the gym where, if you're just going to do the same thing all the time or train for appearance, really, it can get so stale so fast. But training for outside events, it just opens up a whole new incredible world to you, not only for the events, but also for your gym life. Certainly that's been my experience, and the athletes around the world who follow our stuff, they kind of fall into that. It's interesting how people have been following our stuff for years and like, I did this, I went and climbed Rainier, I just did a go ruck. I'm going to go do a three-gun, you know, shooting contest. And, you know, this summer I'm looking at a 50-miler, you know, 50-mile ultra race. And they're able to use our programming for all those types of events. And you can imagine their gym life. It's so much variety. It's so interesting.
Right. So, yeah, I guess having that mindset as a professional athlete, tactical athlete, as someone you're training to do the thing you like to do outside the gym, that can really help civilians out a lot.
Yeah, especially as a, especially when their programming or training starts getting stale. Having an outside, something outside to train for can really enhance their training life.
So let's talk about more specifically the what programming looks like at MTI. I mean, your workouts, I've seen a few of them. They look CrossFit-like, but it's not really CrossFit. Cause you're doing things, you're doing Olympic lifts, you're doing sandbags, things like that, sprints. What do you think the difference between what you do at MTI and what you might see at a CrossFit workout?
What is interesting about our programming is, in general, that the sessions, every session has a certain goal. And so it's been a long time since I've taken a look at it. And within the CrossFit world, there's, you know, all the different gyms have different approaches. And CrossFit is known primarily for their work capacity, short, hard work capacity events. And we deploy some of that similar programming in our stuff. But every session will have a different training objective. And right now, in general, we have four or five different training objectives. One is just relative strength. Another is work capacity, which I spoke of a little bit before. Another is chassis integrity, which is our approach to midsection strength training, midsection strength and strength endurance. On the tactical side, we have something called TAC-SEPA, which stands for tactical speed, explosive power, and agility. And then for both the tactical and mountain side, we have endurance programming that we do. And then on the mountain side, we have climbing programming. So as part of our general programming for mountain athletes, one or two times a week, we've got them in a rock gym, you know, doing intervals on a system board or bouldering problems or something like that. So it's difficult to look at one of our individual specific training sessions and say, you know, this is what we do all the time. But in general, every session will have training objective. What is the main difference between us, I guess, as CrossFit is we're training for outside performance. And so that is what gives us the liberty, really, to take and have these different focuses for the training sessions. The other areas that we probably do a lot more endurance than they do in the typical CrossFit side. And when I say endurance, you know, we're not into the I mean, we do some long running and some long rucking, some long endurance. I believe you have to go long to train long to go long, and so that's a big part. I guess it's kind of hard to take a one session snapshot and say that way we do. That's what we do, and perhaps that's the biggest difference between us and CrossFit is a lot of times you can take one session of a typical CrossFit workout, and everything is going to be fairly similar. It's not the case with us. It's much different for us.
Well, let's take a look at with the strength side. I mean, what are you guys doing? Is it body weight stuff, lifting weights? What kind of thing do we see on developing that relative body weight strength?
We do. We've developed actually five or six different strength progressions over the years that we use to develop relative strength. And most of those are barbell-based. But when I say strength progression, you know, for example, the 5-3-1, which is a popular, 5-5-5 is a popular strength progression. We've developed our own strength progression. So we use barbell strength. We use everything from 1RM and then broken down from that percentage-based progression based on 1RMs. We use something we call Big 24, where we'll have an athlete do work up to a 3RM and then do a progression based on a 3RM. We have a progression we call 3-5-7, where we'll deploy a 1RM, a percentage-based effort based on that 1RM in the same session, and then also have, right after that, a hard body weight-based work capacity effort, 3 to 7 minutes long, which complements the strength work that was done previously. complements, meaning deploys the same movements and muscles, movement patterns and muscles. And the idea is to elicit some of that hormonal flush that they kind of get out of a CrossFit to enhance the strength work. So sometimes we'll take and we'll step out of barbell work to do body weight focused cycle of strength training, primarily just to unload for a while. When I say relative strength, I mean strength per body weight. That doesn't mean body weight strength. For example, our strength standard for tactical athletes is a 1.5 body weight bench press and front squat. So if I weigh 150 pounds, I want to be able to front squat and bench press 225. That's one of our strength standards for tactical athletes. So it's not like we want to be able to do, you know, so many air squats in a certain time. That's strength endurance. We're interested in relative strength.
So I mean, I know you can't get like a broad sweeping look at what a program looks like, but it sounds like you're going to have a workout where you'll do some strength followed by some work capacity, and then the next day you might do some endurance work, depending on what your mission-specific goal is.
Right, either the mission-specific goal or, and again, in general, the way our programming work is the further you are from the event, the more general your programming can be, and we call that general programming, we call that base programming, mountain base, military base, law enforcement base. That general programming isn't totally random. There's definitely a focus to that, and that focus is training those different attributes that we want to train. So, for example, let's say we have a guy who's going to SFAS, which is Green Beret Selection, and he's got 6 months to train our Green Beret Selection specific program. We call the rec-based selection training program is 8 weeks long. We want him to do that program right the 8 weeks right before he goes to selection. So that's 2 months. We've got 4 months for him to do other stuff. And that other stuff is what we call our tactical base. So he'll be working on cycles that train relative strength, work capacity, endurance, tactical SEPA, and chassis integrity. So his typical week may – Monday he's coming in and he's doing TAC SEPA, agility, and strength. Tuesday he's out rucking with a 45-pound pack for 6 miles. Wednesday he comes in, he does another half session of relative strength. The second half is work capacity. Thursday he's going to go out and do 800 intervals based on a 3-mile run time he did before. We're working on his speed over ground for running. Friday comes in, he does work capacity and chassis integrity, and then Saturday is another long ruck. So you can kind of see how that kind of works together. We're trying to train all those different attributes concurrently. Now when he gets to that 8 weeks before selection, the idea of training that stuff concurrently goes out the window. We're not concerned about that anymore. We want to get that athlete sport specifically ready for special forces selection. What does that mean? It means we're going to greatly increase his rucking. He's going to do a lot more rucking. The first thing he's going to do when he gets there, he's going to have to do the APFT, the Army Physical Fitness Test, push-ups, sit-ups, 2-mile run. So we're going to, the first day of our plan, he's going to take the APFT, and we're going to use his scores on that APFT, that initial one, and for specific progression as he works through our plan. He's also going to get team events and just work capacity smokers at selection. Long days where they'll just come out and they'll mess with the guys, right? So we've developed work capacity events, sandbag work, dumbbell work, stuff in a vest or an IBA, individual body armor. Now his sport-specific plan will train all these different attributes, get him specifically ready for special forces selection. It includes a Saturday long ruck. So he'll work up, I think, like 18 miles on Saturdays just for rucking. It's a very intense, super focused on the fitness demands at selection. It includes a taper. The last week is a taper. It's assessment based. So the athlete will come in. The first week is an assessment week. He'll do programming based on his assessment results. Week four, we'll reassess him. We're assuming he's going to get more fit, and then we'll reset all the progressions for the last few weeks. And then the last week is a taper week. So hopefully we're sending him in to SFAS, sport specifically fit for that event, but also relatively fresh so it can hammer and get ready to hit it hard when he gets there.
That sounds awesome. I'm a civilian. I don't plan on joining the Green Berets. That sounds like an awesome program. I mean, so after that, what does a maintenance program look like? Let's say you're a first responder, you're a police officer, you're in the military, you're on active duty, you've passed the test. Is there like a set maintenance program do you follow, or are you all always constantly updating that to, I don't know, make it exciting, make it fresh, but also ensure that these guys are ready to do their job?
Yeah, once he gets done with selection, he's going to drop back into that tactical base programming. The tactical base programming has its own, over the years, each tactical base programming cycles, even on a mountainside, and all our cycles now are 6 weeks long, and each of them has a certain emphasis. So we'll be training on the tactical side, on the military side, you know, relative strength, work capacity, endurance, chassis integrity, TACSEPA concurrently. But within each cycle, we'll take a couple of those attributes and we'll place some emphasis on them. So, for example, this cycle, a base cycle, maybe there's emphasis on strength and work capacity. An unload week, the next cycle will be emphasis on chassis integrity and tactical agility. An unload week, the next emphasis will be on endurance. So the athlete is still training all those different fitness attributes, but each cycle has a little bit of emphasis to get that athlete better in that attribute. And what we've kind of found is that methodology creates a pretty incredible variety for the different athletes. We talk about what we call the burden of constant fitness for tactical and even mountain athletes, professional mountain athletes, but especially tactical athletes, military, fire rescue, and law enforcement. These guys, or these athletes, I hate to say guys, we work with plenty of female athletes, but these athletes, they can never really afford to be out of shape. And so they got to be constantly training, and that creates a burden. It can really lead to staleness in your programming if you keep on doing the same thing. Over the years, we found that our base fitness cycles really do a great job of addressing the staleness and keeping things interesting. Generally, in a base fitness cycle, you know, there will be some type of assessment. For example, I mentioned the one earlier. Maybe he'll be, you know, come out in the first week of the cycle. The athlete will need to do a 1 mile or a 3 mile run for time, and they will do progressions based on that assessment. The middle cycle will reassess it, and that assessment and kind of measuring yourself really helps keep things interesting. As well, our programming is continually evolving. Just this past couple years, we changed the way we train mid-session strength completely with our new chassis integrity theory. We introduced TACSEPA. So it's not like our programming is static. We're continually evolving it as we look to find things that work better, work well. One of the changes that we made just this past year was we got away from what I call garbage reps. I'm 48. I've probably been doing my programming longer than anybody, and my knees are just stiff. They're pretty damn stiff all the time now, and I wonder if all the lightly loaded squats and lunges I did in the past, kind of following, you know, like a bunch of thrusters to a run or something, if that had impacted my knees. So we've gotten away from, if we're going to work a deep squatting movement, we're going to go either really heavy or body weight. We're not going to do just moderately loaded stuff. So our programming, I guess, what I'm trying to impart is that we're always evaluating what we're doing, trying to do it better, thinking about mission performance, long-term longevity for the athletes, mission durability, all those types of things. And if you're doing your job well, no matter what your profession is, you're always looking to continuously improve. And with that continuous improvement, from the athlete's perspective, is this programming that hopefully is getting them ready for their job, but also is really interesting and intriguing to do. And hopefully keeping them interested in their programming and their training and making them fit for their jobs.
Awesome. Well, Rob, this has been a great conversation. Where can people go to learn more about what you do at MTI and find out more about signing up for some of your programs you have available?
Yeah, just our website, just mtntactical.com, and everything's right there.
Well, Rob Shaul, thanks so much for your time. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you so much, Brett.
My guest today was Rob Shaul. He's the founder and president of the Mountain Tactical Institute. You can find more information about the programming they do there at Mountain Tactical Institute by going to mtntactical.com.